The second afternoon discussion session, and here we shall have respondents' remarks first, and thereafter discussion on the paper by Professor Sachchidanand Mishra. The paper was on concept of mind in the Nyāya system. So I request now Dr. Kuntala Bhattacharya to present her views as a respondent.
Respected Professor Samthin and other dignitaries present, I thank the authority of Central University of Tibetan Studies to give me an opportunity to participate in this conference and also to act as a respondent to this very interesting paper, The Nyāya Concept of Eternal Mind. I would just like to comment on some points. I would just like to make some points by way of initiating discussion on this paper. First of all, the author in this paper has tried to evaluate, as he has himself stated, that he has tried to evaluate the Nyāya theory of mind from two perspectives. First, whether this theory is compatible with the entire Nyāya framework, and second, how it may react to the scientific idea of mind. Now, while dealing with the first, the author states the arguments put forward by the Nyāya to admit mind different from self. Now, he says that an act of cognition requires a knower as well as an instrument of knowing. And two points are to be noted here, that according to the Nyāya, very unlike the Mimamsakas, the Nyāya maintain that cognition is not an act, but it's a quality of the self. So in order for a cognition to take place, there should be a knower as well as an instrument of that cognition. And since self is the knower, mind as distinct from the self should be the instrument. And this is the reason why mind should be different from the self. Now, these arguments actually crisscross, because this argument can as well be advanced or put forth to prove the existence of, to prove that mind is not only different from the self, but also that mind is not a knower. And there are actually other arguments to prove that mind is not the knower. These arguments are that since mind is atomic in nature, and since a knower is said to perceive cognition, desire, and aversion, if mind is the knower, then it should have cognition, desire, etc. But in that case, they being properties of atomic objects should also be atomic and hence would not be perceptible. Now, here the author refers to Tattvasara and to an article by Rakhal Dash Nayaratna, both of which try to show that cognition, volition, etc. are not properties of self, but of mind or of body. So the author concludes that these views are not acceptable because the Nyāya is not willing to go beyond the empirical world, and any theory which it wants to accept must be supported by an example. Now, I just want to make two points here. First is that then the conclusion is that the Nyāya subscribes to non-reductionist view that self, in fact, there were much discussion on whether the mind-body problem can be reduced to a problem in Indian philosophy, as whether consciousness as distinct from matter should be admitted or not. So I'm just stating that self, or the conscious principle, or anything which is the seat of consciousness, and the body are irreducible to each other. None can be reduced to the other. And I will also like to state, as there are many scientists present here, they know better, that the Western concept of mind, which is thought, as its essential quality, or rather I may say that the Western concept of mind, which says that there is a difference between matter and consciousness, this is not always the view which is maintained by modern day scientists. For example, Professor Swamiji Atmapriyanandu, he also maintained that Roger Penrose argues that known laws of physics are inadequate to explain the phenomenon of consciousness. In fact, Penrose proposes the characteristics this new physics may have and specifies the requirements for a bridge between classical and quantum mechanics. He argues against the viewpoint that the rational processes of mind are completely algorithmic and can thus be duplicated by a sufficiently complex computer. Now, going back to what to the author's point, that the author says that these views are not acceptable. That means the reductionist views are not acceptable because the Nyaya is not willing to go beyond the empirical world, and any theory which it wants to accept must be supported by an example. Now, I think that the Nyaya is going beyond, or the Nyaya is being very much counterintuitive later, when the author also states the argument for accepting mind and also for accepting mind as an atomic, as having atomic magnitude. For the argument which is advanced, it's that simultaneous cognitions do not take place in the Nyaya philosophy. It's maintained that two cognitions do not take place at the same time. Now, this conclusion, it is very counterintuitive, though it is supported by an example. But there are philosophers, other Indian philosophers, who believe that mind is non-atomic. Some even maintain that mind is all-pervading or bivu, and they have examples supporting their position. So how to decide between the two? Now, and again, mind is atomic. The Nyaya maintain that mind is atomic because, and since mind is atomic, no two cognitions take place at the same time, though the sense organs and the sense organs are conjoined with the objects. They may conjoin with the objects at the same time. Now, there is another point to be made here, that mind, though atomic, it is unlike other atoms of the four elements in that it cannot be conjoined with another mind to form a whole, because it is defined as that which is devoid of touch. This is a specific quality which mind lacks, which other atoms have, that mind is devoid of touch. Sparsha shunyate svati anutvam. That is the definition of mind. So I would like to ask, what is the, what compels the Nyaya to say that mind, since it is devoid of touch, it cannot be drabhyarambhaka, or it cannot be conjoined with another mind to form a whole or a abhayavi drabhyaha. Now the author then concludes that mind being eternal implies changelessness. Now I feel that this point needs clarification. Now, in what way does eternality imply unchangeability? In fact, if it is so, then the very concept of liberation becomes inexplicable. For a self is bondage is very different from a self liberated. A bound self has, according to the Nyaya, properties like cognition, desire, aversion, pleasure, or pain. A liberated soul or a liberated self is bereft of all these properties. Now, if this is not change, what else can be termed as change? Not only the self, but another, but atomic substances, eternal substances like atoms of the four elements, according to the Nyaya, according to the Vaisheshika, they admit change in atoms due to heat, and Pakaja, Sparsha, they are developed. And The Nyaya philosophers, they also admit that an atom changes when heat is applied to it, as well as the whole. The atom as the part and as well as the whole, all of them undergo change when heat is applied to them. So I would just request the request Professor Mishra to explain that what he understands by change, because it's not only abhayava anyatha. We can also define change as jahat dharmantarang purvam upadatti jat aparam tad apruchyata dharmi parinamo sa uchyate. That means when a substance, the qualities or properties of a substance are changed, the substance itself is changed, one has to admit this, otherwise liberation cannot be explained. That is what, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kuntala Bhattacharya. There are two basic questions to be discussed. One is, given the nature and function of manas as conceived in the Nyaya system, can we not assign these functions to jiva or atman on the one hand, or to mastishka as a part of the body, and do away with the very concept of manas in the Nyaya Vaisheshika system? This is one moot question. The other is, if we grant admissibility of manas, why should it be regarded as eternal? Just as in the Sankhya and the Advaita Vedanta, antakaran is not eternal. In Buddhism also, chitta is not eternal. We have chitta vithi, and there are 10 stages of chitta vithi, as discussed in Abhidhamma Mata Sangaho. Well, why should we regard mind as eternal? What benefit do we get thereby? And so now you can
respond. Thank you very much. I am very much thankful to Dr. Kuntala Bhattacharya raising such questions. Because there are many problems which I wanted to discuss, but in my paper I could not discuss, and now I have the opportunity to discuss those issues. And these are actually very important questions. First of all, she raised the question that cognition is not an act, but a quality. And it is very good observation, very good question. But if I am not wrong, the model which I gave you in explaining the idea of production of cognition, in that production I did not intend to say that cognition is an act actually, but cognition is the product. Product, as the case of an axe is used to cut the tree, so the product is produced in that tree. So in the same way, when the soul is using mind, manas, to know something, so the thing is known and the product is produced, the result is produced. So this is a quality which is generated in the Atman. So in that way, the example is very well justifiable. In this case, we can accommodate it. Third, second question you raised, that why mind is atomic? Because there are many philosophers who accept that mind is not atomic. And I explained it. The point is that there are three possibilities. Gangesh Upadhyaya in his Tattva Chintamani raises that there are three possibilities. Either manas is mahat parimana, is endowed with mahat parimana, or it is atomic, or it is middle sized. So if it is having mahat parimana, then it will be conjoined to everything. And in that case, the purpose will be defeated. Purpose is forfeited, for which we are accepting the existence of mind. We are postulating the existence of mind. This is to say, yugupas jnanan utpattir, because it is connected to everything. So every sense organ will be able to produce cognition at every moment. And if we accept manas is middle-sized, so the problem will be there again, because the manas will be able to be connected with all sense organs. So the purpose is defeated again. And again, if it is middle side, then it must be non-eternal. And if it is non-eternal, then other issues are coming here. And those are very problematic issues. The problematic issues are there that because Atman is Vibhu, so there is no movement in Atman. So how the Nayayikas will explain the process of rebirth? Because Atman is omnipresent, it is all pervasive, it is conjoined with every body. This is to say, my soul is not only conjoined to this body, but it is conjoined to the bodies of all the people. So why I am feeling pain, suffering, happiness, pleasure, etc., cognition only in this body? And this is explicable only taking into account the idea of manas. Therefore, manas should be accepted and it should be atomic and it should be eternal. Without accepting it eternal, we are faced with the difficulty how to explain this idea. So third point is that there are many scientists who raise the point as Roger Penn raised you. Swami Atma Priyanandji mentioned that there is a possibility of mind other than brain. But this is the main line of thought. When we are studying, there is a book by The Emerging Mind, and the brain changes itself. There are so many issues here. And the main focus is there that the science is talking about changing brain. And when you are postulating something which is unchanging, that is not brain at all, according to them. That should be something different, but it is not brain. And on the basis of brain, which is not changing, you cannot explain this changing world, changing phenomena. That is their idea, and according to they explain. So the Nyaya point is that this is to say that manas is unchanging. It is not changing because it is eternal. So there is no special quality. There are the qualities which are there, those are general qualities. Just now I had been talking to Professor Joshiji that manas is endowed with only general qualities. There is no special quality is present there. And all those general qualities are there, and those doesn't get produced. So there is no change at all in the soul. In that sense, you can say that there is change in Atman, because the qualities are getting produced. But in the manas, the qualities are not getting produced. So in that sense too, the manas is changeless and eternal. Lastly, Professor Bhatt has raised a very important point that why this function cannot be assigned to the soul itself. And I remember there is a very frequently quoted statement by Acharya Shankara. He says that nahi atyantam chaturupi natabatuhu swaskandham arudham shaknoti. If there is a very very expert acrobat, he cannot ride his own soldier. His own shoulder he cannot ride. In the same way, if the soul is the knower, he cannot act as the instrument. So there must be a difference between the knower, the doer, and the instrument through which the person is performing an act. And this statement of Acharya Shankar is very much common to the Nyaya idea and the explanations which Nayayikas propound, postulate. So these are the points which I wanted to say. Thank you very much. Yeah, eternity is changed, and not only this one, but eternity, eternal as well as, actually there are two kinds of change. In two ways you can understand the change. One is that the thing is going to modifications. Another is the thing is not going to modifications. But there are certain qualities which emerge and some perishes. So this could be the possibility. And both these possibilities excluded in manas. Therefore, the Nayayika's manas is changeless.
Actually, I would like to state that once mind is conjoined with Atman, then that conjunction is also a property of the mind. And when that property changes, so, no, it's both a property of the soul and the mind, because a conjunction is Uvaya Sambandhi, yes. So it's not that all the none of the properties of the mind changes. Sometimes they change, yes.
Yeah, this is a very good observation, that if there is a connection between manas and soul, there is a conjunction, sanyoga, between these two. Sanyoga is also a kind of quality, and sanyoga is dvishta. It is present in two, not only in Atman, but also in manas. So in that way, you can talk about that manas is changing. But actually, the change is not understood in that way. In that way, actually, avikaryo yamuchyate, this is a statement regarding Atman. And avikarya is understood that where there is no kriya. So in soul, there is no kriya. Therefore, it is avikarya, Atman. And in this way, you can see that the soul, this manas is active. So there is kriya. So in that way, you cannot say that it is changeless. But the point is that it is eternal. And in that way, special qualities are not there. In that way, you can understand that this is changeless. Yeah, yeah, surely. Actually, the Nyayikas are not talking about change. The term is very much alien to Nyaya philosophy, change, because they, except when they say that cloth, threads become cloth, it doesn't mean that threads are changed. This is a new creation. And when something new is created, there is no change at all. So there is no change at all in Nyaya philosophy.
Because of Asatkarya.
Yes. Professor Mishra ji has given a very important answer, I think, that the Nyaya philosophers can't talk of change because they are Arambhavadins. I have just one question, a small one, a query to a Nyayiko, that if Yugapat Jnana Nutpatti is admitted, if there is really non-production of two simultaneous cognitions, this conception of the mind is almost inevitable. No one can bar it at any place. But what about Yugapat Jnana Nutpatti? The kind of arguments the Nyayikos are giving refer to particular examples, such as Alata Chakra Darshana Shatatala Patra Bhedo. But please see, Alata Chakra Darshana and Shatatala Patra Bhedo are cases of Brahma. They are cases of erroneous perception, where the talapatras are, the needle passes through shatatalapatra consecutively and not simultaneously, but that appears as simultaneous. It's a case of erroneous perception. Alata chakra darshan, the chakra is moving and we are seeing it as a fire moving. But the point is, but the fire is at one point of time at this moment and at another time at this moment. There is no continuum, but only discrete places where the fire exists. So all, both of these are cases of erroneous perception, and they are giving explanations or accounts of how those errors take place. But why do you think that normal cases of simultaneous perceptions are erroneous ones? Suppose the standard example, Dirgha Shashkuri Bhakkhana Stalo. I am smelling the papur, I am smelling the Dirgha Shashkuri, yes. And I am hearing the sound and I am tasting it, I am seeing it. Why do we think, why should we think that this is a case of erroneous perception? The perceptions are actually taking place consecutively.
This will be the last question. Speak loudly on the mic.
Uh, the concluding remark, one of the concluding remarks was, mind is eternal. And anything to be eternal must be free from time and space. When mind perceives, it is relative to time and space, or time or space. That's why mind cannot be eternal, according to a mathematician and philosopher, both A.N. Whitehead, and according to any student of science who believes that these two master variables determine the eternity of anything.
Thank you. You want to say something?
Again, it is related to eternality again. When a substance has certain qualities, and now some qualities are destroyed, new qualities come into existence, can't you say that the substance undergoes change? Yeah. For example, Atman has cognition. One cognition now, next it gets destroyed, some new cognition arises. And you want to maintain that Atman is eternal. But Atman does undergo change. So this is a kind
every
of...
Every beginning problem. Calls for a change. So Arambhavad is not in opposition to change.
Let me begin with Professor Gokhale's question. The Nayayikas make a very clear-cut distinction between substance and quality. These two are not identical. So if quality is destroyed and another quality is produced, then substance is this in the same way. There is no change in substance. Substance is not changed. Therefore, the Nayayikas wouldn't accept it that this is a kind of change. Because the quality is destroyed and another quality is produced. So why it is said, the very famous example, Shikhi Dhvastaha. Shikhi Dhvastaha, a person comes after cutting his hair. So the person is the same. And he has lost only his hair, or he has colored his hair. So in that way, the person is not changed. The person is the same. So this is the point. Okay? So second question is Yugapas Jnanan Utpatti. And I wanted to discuss this point in my paper, and also I left it. Gangesh Upadhyaya takes his point very clearly, and I also explained very briefly that while moving the car, when you are driving a car, there are many things you see, you move, many things are going on. So in that case, why couldn't you accept that there are simultaneously cognitions are getting produced? So Gangesh Upadhyaya gives a very brilliant answer. That suppose you are doing something very intuitively and you are tallina, you are doing it with your mind. And somebody invites you, somebody asks you many times, gives your name many times. But you couldn't listen to. It happens to me many times. My wife's asked me many times and I couldn't listen to because I am studying. So it may happen. And in that case, why it is not happening? Because your mind was somewhere else. It was attached to something else with another sense organ. Therefore, and if you accept that simultaneously cognitions are getting produced, it will be difficult to explain this point. Therefore, you have to accept that manas is atomic and it can get connected to only one sense organ at one moment. And coming to the Professor Harikesh Singh's question, the Nayayikas would not share this idea in that way because as Whitehead said, that to be free from time and space, if it is some free from time and space, only in that case it will be eternal. The Nyāya accept that if something is something never gets destroyed, it is eternal. So in that sense, it is free from space, time and space, because it is not present. And in the idea of eternality, it is not that it must be free from space. It is in body. It is present in Sharira, but it moves from one place to another. So it is certainly not free from space. But the idea of eternal mind is something which
is not limited to any time moment. Therefore, it is eternal. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Now we may invite another respondent, and she is Professor Meenakshi Thapan. So, Meenakshi.